And obviously Mata's Karma, which we're seeing already banned away, and KT highlighting the Syndra immediately.
Yeah, other things to think about, definitely Lucian for Deft. He was showing some pretty sick games on that, especially against MVP. But of course, the Ezreal, another Deft pick that they look to ban away here first.
This is patch 7.6. Galio's not enabled, though. Camille now being banned away by KT, not wanting to give that up. And MVP are on blue side, and you know that they want Graves for Beyond. And so now the question is, does KT give it to them? MVP focusing on those bans. Now, when I was looking at some of the solo queue accounts, Maha, lots and lots of games on Kog'Maw lately, whereas for the most part, across KT's accounts, there's nothing too out of the ordinary. Another thing I'm interested to see is, will LeBlanc appear in this series? Pawn was playing her a bit, but not with the Gunblade variation.
Interesting to see KT ban out Zyra. We saw actually during the analyst desk, well, at least we did in the studio, that Mata right now is 7-0 on Zyra, but not choosing to pick that. And there's that Graves that you were talking about being highlighted, but they do switch it to Ashe. Still some thought going into this first pick for MVP, and there it is, locked in. Ashe will be the first pick.
I feel like this means KT can respond with Rumble Graves here if they really want to, and they can get two really powerful picks under their belt. And now Malzahar actually being highlighted. That would be for Mata, and it gives them a lot of forms of engage, and the roams that come out of him in the mid game are going to be very scary. So actually electing not to take the Graves right here, and this might be a little bit of a mind game.
It's very interesting because they know if MVP picks Graves here, they might just be comfortable to go ahead, throw a score on the Elise, or maybe even something like Elise Sin in this first round of picking. We do see the Nautilus picked up, one of the strongest top laners currently. Definitely see that Rumble versus Nautilus matchup in the top lane very often.
It's like MVP highlighting the Elise. And we saw in the series with MVP versus Afrika that, you know, Beyond can play other junglers. This is very peculiar to see Graves making it to the second ban phase. And KT, they finalize out their draft with the Varus, so lots of power on their red side. They're gonna have the red side Varus, and they have red Rumble. Lots of ability to stall out the game, deny Baron.
I guess that's what score looks like. Today I learned. I'm not sure about that. But another ban focused at Ian. You can see that Orianna taken away from him as well. And they're looking to take away Pawn's Talon. Nothing too out of the ordinary here so far in the second banning phase.
So the thing is here is that KT already has a ton of magic damage on their team composition. So I'm wondering if MVP now will actually elect to ban away the Graves last and force score onto a Lee Sin or a Kha'Zix. And that would give Beyond the favorable matchup.
Good call. And we've been seeing a lot of Beyond Elise as well. So pretty comfortable there. There's that Lee Sin.
Being highlighted, they just want to get this out of the way, and they want to give Pawn the counter pick. Jace is still open. So definitely a possibility if they want to go with that. MVP now. Highlighting LeBlanc, will they lock her in? The new Gunblade variation, very strong. So they do lock that in. And now it looks like Lulu will be the support of choice.
Seen a lot of Lulu recently, especially ever since 7.5. And Corki being hovered here. We don't see this pick all too often, and it is going to be locked in. So Pawn on the Corki mid.
Really interesting last pick. They're going to have a lot of playmaking potential with the Equalizer and Corki's package in the mid game, and definitely a lot of mobility that can come out of their team composition. Not quite the Jace, and This does mean that MVP can get a little bit better itemization paths off against KT.
Yeah, also that Corki versus LeBlanc mid, you can always Valkyrie away from the chain just to make sure that you can get to safety. And obviously just a lot of escapes against the decent amount of pick that this MVP lineup does have. Been seeing a lot of MVP.
MVP's team composition, running the dual teleport, they will have the split push mechanic available to them, but as you pointed out, lots of pick available inside of it. And KT's comp, it's more so focused on the mid-game, mid-range team composition this time around. This is one last look. Nautilus, Elise, LeBlanc, Ashe, and Lulu for MVP. And then for KT, Rumble, Lee Sin, Corki, Varus, and Malzahar. So Score's gonna have to find some cracks in MVP's armor early on to make stuff happen for his mid and top lane.
It's going to be very interesting to see if he can pop off and make one or both of those lanes pop off with him as well. Guys, we're going to be jumping into game number one right now. Get out there, tell your friends that this playoff match is on. Let's jump into it. So here we go. Equal representation. You were talking about MVP getting better and better slowly and slowly over the course of this split. And they just seem to come together as a team more and more. Look like one of the best, you know, teamwork-centric types of teams. And it seems like perhaps they've been gaining more and more fans over the course of this split as well.
Very reminiscent almost of Ozone from many years ago. They don't necessarily have the best players at any position, but as you mentioned, as a unit, as a group, they are performing, you know, up to par with some of the higher tier teams in the region, and they do just keep getting better. And the MVP organization, I mean, it's an org that is renowned for its coaching staff and selection of rosters and how to put together groups, so no surprise that yet again, their LoL squad is continuously getting better, and they're looking to be the dark horse and try to run all the way to the finals.
Very excited for this team. You know, we've seen KT. You were talking about in terms of just star players. You look at KT, and pretty much every single position has a star player in it. And the problem for them really has just been perhaps overconfidence. Oh, hold that thought. We have an early exhaust coming in. Mono wants to make a trade here with the Voidlings. You can see Max taking an immense amount of damage from Deft too. That's going to get them a pretty decent lead early on in this lane.
They take that trade. Max and Maha are low, but it does come at the expense of the exhaust. And what this means is that Score has potential to make his way down to bottom, especially if Deft and Mata can control the top half of the lane and prevent Maha and Max from getting a ward. Something to look out for. Beyond now, just actually electing to get the Scuttle Crab and then perhaps look to gank top or mid lane. He's really the one that has a lot more potential to set up ganks.
Coming on in here, there's the flash from Pawn pretty early on to just escape from that early gank from Beyond. We started blue, and you can see the pings come down. They're like, oh, okay, he started blue. He didn't start red side or the Raptors, which is what you'd see more often.
And so Score's gonna get a little bit of an experience advantage, and those pings did notify all of his teammates of exactly what camps Beyond has cleared. So now they know where he can and can't be for about the next minute or two.
Let's see what Score wants to do. He's already level 4, and coming on to the Scuttle Crab, he's cleared out pretty much everything except the top Krugs on his side of the map. Does pick up the Scuttle Crab. Looks like he's just going to go back home and buy first. No plays being made just yet.
Deft taking a little bit of a chunk. He's even going to... Oh, I thought he was going to potentially lose out on all three of those minions, but he ends up getting them. A really key moment down in bottom lane.
Yeah, You have to question that move that they made at level one. You know, the exhaust being used means that they have a very hard time. Oh, wow, Max really wants to stop that recall. But yeah, they have a really hard time, but eventually with the biscuits after level one, you just play a little bit passive. And then from there, you know you can fight, especially with the ignite that actually Max picked up. And so far, that means a pretty early recall here in the bot lane for Deft.
And with Deft recalling, this means that Mata gets a little bit of solo XP, so it does enhance the speed at which he catches level 6, and then Deft is going to get that as well as Mata recalls. And it did force Maha and Max to stay a little bit longer in bottom lane. So now Deft and Mata do have control over how the late wave will play out.
Oh, really nice dredge line into the cocoon here. Smebby does have blast. Does he elect to use it? It looks like no. First blood will be given over to Beyond on the Elise.
That's really big that they get that first blood up in top lane and alleviate the pressure, because Nautilus can really spiral out of control against this KT team competition. If he gets too tanky too early, there's too much pressure on Deft and Score to try to bring him down. And in the mid-game team fights, it could end up being disastrous if things keep going poorly up in top. Triple Doron's Ring picked up for Ed. Now Beyond, he's playing on the left-hand side of the map quite a lot, giving a little bit of respect to Maha and Max being able to hold everything down on their own, and Score is not been able to find anything so far.
Yeah, I mean, you were talking about perhaps Score had to make something work up in top and mid, and maybe Beyond just wants to mirror that a little bit, but so far, Score has kind of just been farming up. He was looking for a gank in mid with double control ward around the bottom side of the mid river, but nothing was happening as Ian kind of sensed it and didn't go for any kind of engage onto pawn. So far things looking pretty good for MVP. The gold's even, so, you know, they do get that first blood, but a bit of CS lead in terms of Deft a little bit ahead and Smeb just a bit as well.
All the laners for KT are out farming their opponents, so they have that going for them. And also the vision control that they had around Beyond's red side jungle was absolutely beautiful. Now we can see that Score and Mata doing a little bit of an invade.
Yeah, look at this. Score actually not level 6 yet, whereas Beyond was. If he had level 6, he might have been able to flash kick it back into a kill. But not quite there.
Vaughn now shoving in the wave. He knows that he can expend his mana quite a bit, as the blue buff is going to be coming up shortly. So he doesn't mind all that much. Score continuing to try to maybe make something happen.
Still not level 6, but coming on in here. Score actually eating a ton of damage. Beyond able to turn that one around and repel up into the sky. The flash exhaust, though, from Mata, but Ian is trying to come in here and do a bit of damage. But look at that amount of damage that comes out from the Malzahar. But here comes Maha on the chase. Perhaps KT staying a little bit too long. That's going to be two more kills, a double kill now to Maha.
KT making really bizarre decisions right there. It was questionable why Score went in on that. MVP reacting so quickly, and the game just completely flips around. A lot of stuff went over to bottom lane now for MVP, and so what was mostly going to be like a 3v2 scenario turning around, but Ian getting picked off by Deft, that's a really big salvage.
Deft calm as ever, just chewing his bubble gum.
He's so mad. He's so furious.
Like, God, why does my team feed every time? I'm just trying to carry here.
Take another look at this replay. So Beyond is clearing out the ward. Score goes in, having level 5. You see Pawn, he has no mana. And Ian was right there to respond. And Maha was way too far away. And then you can see that the bottom lane for MVP, super quick to respond. Deft not in position to do so. So once Max gets here, it's all too easy for him and Maha to bring down Mata and Pawn. And that came at a lot of summoner spells going down.
Yeah, I mean, that was flash exhaust from Mata. Deft, he had to flash in actually for the kill out to Ian. Baja only using his flash to pick up the kill onto, I think it was Pawn during that fight. Score looking to make a move up here in top lane. So far, just a Spectral Cowl on this Nautilus. So will be good against Rumble's damage, but not so much against Lee Sin. He lands the Sonic Wave. There's the flash into the kick. Still not that much damage, but there's the slow from the missile. Will flash the wall, and Ed is on the run now. And Bianna's immediately going to start onto that Cloud Drake. Not the biggest reward in the world, but Ed, he's just not getting out of here. Pawn even coming on over to help out with that kill. But this will mean a free Cloud Drake over to MVP.
MVP pick up the Cloud Drake, and that'll help them out with their split pushes later on. Ed did his best to try to waste as much time as possible. Did come at the cost of his flash, though. And so KT getting the ball rolling for Smeb a little bit now up in top lane. He's going to almost have that Leandre's Torment available to him.
There it is. Picks it up, as you were saying. Taking a look at the items, the 80 carries, both going Blade of the Rune King. That's kind of flavor of the month. Pretty much everyone picking that up first nowadays.
And right now, all that we're going to be waiting to see is what happens around the 15, 16, 17 minute mark when the next dragon spawns, because KT, they're not going to want to give over two Cloud Drakes to MVP for no reason. And that's going to be when the mid-game team fight breaks out. So anything between now and then is really crucial, especially in bottom and top lane, as it's really going to dictate exactly how that fight will pan out.
Yeah, definitely will. I feel like Pawn's Corki is going to be pretty nice in those fights. You were mentioning the package earlier on, but that Hex Drinker itemization is just so easy for him up against LeBlanc, Elise, and even Ed on the Nautilus. Will mitigate a ton of that damage, and looks like he's going straight into Phase and probably Trinity Force right after.
He's going to immediately go into that Trinity Force. It's going to be delayed, certainly, though, because of that Hex Drinker first pickup, as you were mentioning. So he won't quite have the damage output in that initial teamfight, but he's going to have more tankiness available to him, and so he's not going to need that damage entirely, as long as Deft is big.
They're making a big play down here in bot. MVP wants to punish here and potentially go into a break, but here we go, the big arrow onto Deft. He is gone, baby, gone. No way to survive that one. And you can see the immediate ping onto that bot turret that's already very low. Wouldn't be surprised if they look to take that down here first.
And it looks like they are going to try to get first blood turret. I can't see top lane's HP, though. I don't know who's going to win the race. Looks like it will indeed be MVP. KT, yeah, just a few seconds behind. We're going to shove that lane in. And so right now, if you look at the gold score up in top, it's pretty close to even. Only a 700 gold lead right now for MVP. So this game is still anybody's game. Maha finally picking up some more damage now. And him and Beyond are the ones with the majority of the gold and the kills. You can see that Ian's still a little bit ways away from that Gunblade. But with bottom lane being opened up, the rotations are going to start, and this is where it's going to benefit the dual teleport and the mobility of that LeBlanc and the Elise with that Cloud Drake enhancing it.
Motto is waiting in the wings here. He's hit level 6 on this Malzahar, and he has his flash exhaust up, so definitely is looking for another pick for his team, trying to strike back after Maha getting a nice little arrow onto his buddy Deft. Max just hanging around. Ed is actually coming into mid. Pawn here, he's got to be careful. Will Valkyrie away, but there's the Dreads line into the arrow. Immediate knock-up. And even the Wild Growth committed to here, that's going to be another kill fed over to Maha in the bot lane. Nice little string of plays there by the Nautilus Ed.
Really nice roam, and MVP likes to do this all the time. They like to have Ed roam down and make plays, and this is how they get their advantages and they get leads, is through team coordinated play, proper vision control, roams, KT, they pick up bottom lane during this. Deft is going to recall right now, but Mata and Score tied up in mid. MVP really want to get this mid turret. They're busting this game wide open.
These guys are just on a roll. I mean, they spanked Afrika, and then they come in here against KT, the team. You look at all the members, and it's like, well, on paper, KT is supposed to win 100% of the time. But MVP just looks like such a better team. They're playing so well together. And it's as you mentioned it, the game is now busted wide open. And I'm scared for KT's mental state here as it goes on. If they get destroyed in game one, they're not going to be feeling good about game two. And if MVP gets ahead 2-0, it's not going to be looking too good here for KT.
So one of the things I was talking about just before the broadcast is I think that in any scenario where MVP gets two wins in this series, they take it home. They're going to win if they ever get to two wins. And I feel like KT going into a game five, or if they're down 2-0, there's going to be a mental collapse because they already know that it's a superstar lineup, and here we are in the round of two. They didn't live up to expectations, and you know, we've heard that there's some disagreements in the team when it comes to macro calls and shot calling and stuff that they've tried to work on and improve, but we'll see what happens in the series. It's a best of five. It's going to be a new experience for this team as a whole.
Yeah, definitely is for sure. And we've seen a lot of times KT, their aggression, it gets them ahead. They try to win lanes and just go off of that, use their mechanical skill to just bust the game wide open, and the way that MVP is doing this time around. But now they're behind. Now they have to play from behind. They kind of have to play, you know, Samsung's game, even MVP's games at times, and try to stick in this one and make good macro calls, like you were saying, and somehow play as a team. We haven't seen it all too often. The Cloud Drake spawned, and MVP was in position, but they kind of decided to just let it stay up. It's almost like they're baiting KT into potentially taking a fight here.
I think that's what they want to do. Although it's a little bit questionable, you can see the items that MVP have right now, some of them are still waiting on the completion of some of their items. They just have the recipe components, and so they might want to delay until that can occur.
Ooh, big play made here onto Deft. Misses the chains, but look at that burst damage coming out here from Ian. And actually the flash Nethergrasp here onto Maha. They're going to go all in on him. That was about four ultimates used there to take him out. Looks like three. And they do, in fact, pick up the Ash, so nicely done.
Really quick, decisive call, and that's really big that they bring down Maha, because that means that now only sources of magic damage still remain.
And it looks like MVP wanted to take another fight here. Big knockups by Ed to save Beyond's life. But it was kind of scary as they were kind of checking the brushes here.
And they're having pawn shove in bottom lane, so they're making sure that mid and bot lane go dark before they look to capture an objective, but this could backfire unless they get another pick right here.
Looking for the pick, the hop forward into the kick, and Ian will get away with his life. Ed, though, very tanky. Will he survive the Sonic Wave? And a nice missile there from Pawn will pick up the kill onto Max.
It almost looked like they were actually going to get all three kills right there, but not quite. Ooh. Dev trying to be a sniper. Instead, they're just going to raise the mid-tier one turret here. They get themselves the gold lead. Now they're going to turn their attention to the Cloud Drake. Take that off the map. Bottom and top lane looking very neutral right now as well, so not the best of spots for MVP. And this all occurred off of Ian missing those chains, or that chain.
Yeah.
Onto Deft.
Then for a big play onto Deft, and we're gonna actually see this play here.
So you can see that they're trying to move towards the dragon, but they don't have any proper vision. So KT waiting patiently, almost able to get Ian, almost able to get Ed, but in the end, they only end up picking up Max.
It was a nice little play they used with the brush tactics where they identified that Kate, or rather MVP, they only had four members, they didn't have Vision of the Dragon, and that they could just kind of party bush there. But MVP, they're going to strike back. They want to take the Rift Herald. pretty common thing to see here with the Elise. That's going to be a 1851, it looks like, Rift Herald picked up.
Not a bad pickup by any means. Should, for the most part, last the entire duration of the game. Unless we see something completely outrageous. Don't know what Ian's doing right there. Also, interesting, still no Gunblade completed. Yeah. Oh, Pawn, barely able to escape.
Hey, he wanted to go 1v1 versus the Ashe that has 3 kills already. Somehow, doesn't seem like a good idea, especially when you went into that Hex Drinker first item. But either way, neither of the players do die. Yeah, it's definitely an interesting build path from the LeBlanc. Merlin Omicron.
With that Hextech Revolver, no Gunblade yet, and that's really going to enhance Ian's assassination potential on Deft, Mata, Score, even to a certain extent, at least early on, if he's taking too much damage. But also, they need to get their split push going. Neither of them have Teleport up right now. Baron is on the map, but neither team's really in a position to just outright capture it. It's going to be an opportunistic pickup.
And the third Drake of the game is Cloud Drake again. I mean, it was very windy today in Seoul. I guess they're just trying to stay with the theme of the day, I suppose. But not really going to be a big Drake for either team. I guess it'll be 2 Cloud Drakes to 1. So at the end of the day, probably just 1 Cloud Drake in favor of one team. We'll add to the Elder Drake stacks, no doubt. But oh, looking for a play here onto Beyond. Trying to get that Cocoon. He does land it, and actually the Nethergrass was burned too, and the Cocoon stun actually did deny that. So definitely a good win for MVP. Oh. The arrow barely misses Smet, but the Dredgeline will hit. He's able to flash, though. Lots of damage onto Beyond, who gets blown up immediately. And now KT, they want to go for this really nice equalizer. Everybody from MVP is on the run. Max getting extremely low. Wild Growth on himself, but Ed in the front. He's tanky, but not tanky enough yet. Now Score on the chase. He almost gets Ian there with that Sonic Wave. And 2 more kills picked up here for KT, so they really are striking back.
Yeah, KT were so quick to just punish right now in, oh man. I think that they might go for the Baron. Smeb has Teleport. Seen a lot of teams making these plays. They should be able to pick it up. I don't think that Maha even has a feeling that this is going on. So KT, with a really decisive Baron call, they do manage to pick it up, and that has to make MVP's heart sink. And again, I mean, it was MVP messing up an engagement right there. Smeb just barely able to dodge. Ed locked him up, but then Beyond got locked up. And watch Max flash here and try to get the ultimate onto Beyond, but it was a little bit too late. Equalizer came out. And the punish game from KT was super strong. MVP couldn't try to turn this teamfight around. They just don't have the damage to do so. And this is twice now that something has happened like this for MVP. But we do have to look at it from the point that KT were in a position where they could have been caught out, things could have gone really poorly, and then skill shots missed that shouldn't have.
Yeah, perhaps they're playing against Samsung or SKT and they just get bopped there in that team fight. But MVP, as we said, their strengths lie in their teamwork, their ability to come back in situations like this. So they were enjoying a nice lead early on in this game. They're not out of it yet. KT looking to push now. It looks like 2 lanes. Smeb coming down into bot and the rest of the 4 members up near mid. But Pawn kind of hanging in between both of them will be available with that Valkyrie.
KT's looking to get certainly at least 2 turrets off of this Baron. Dragon's coming up in 45 seconds, though. They just get the cleanse out of Pawn. Aha no longer has his ultimate. Smeb looming on the horizon. He definitely wants an equalizer.
Ooh, the flash Nethergrass bear onto Ian. That's a big target if they can burst him, and they do. Def able to pick up that kill. Now Ad on the run, and this game is beginning to run away from MVP.
KT so quick to punish mispositioning errors of MVP. And with this Baron wave right now, they're certainly going to be able to get the mid-tier 3 turret. Should be able to get the inhibitor here.
Well, Ad, he wants to strike back. He's going to actually catch score. Really nice dredge line there to pick him up, but so much damage coming back. MVP's just not able to stick around. Keep in mind, Smeb wasn't even in that fight. He was pushing the bot lane. Now we got a big push onto bot, and Ad forced to flash away.
And now Ian is here. See if he can do anything. Doesn't look like it. They end up getting chunked even more so. At the end of the day, lots of turrets going down, inhibitor exposed. KT gonna use that Baron enhanced recall, probably beeline straight down to Dragon. Although a ping goes off onto top. They're saying, you know what, we don't actually want the Dragon, unless Score is gonna go solo it. Don't know what's happening on live, but taking a look at the replay, you can see Mata so quick to do that engage, followed up with the equalizer and with Score. And if they can constantly just keep deleting members one by one of MVP, the team composition that MVP has is so reliant on being together as five that they can't afford to have that happen. And now with them being as behind as they are, it becomes even more difficult to actually make a pick or make usage of that double teleport. So in a way, they're actually playing without summoners in that regard.
A really, really rough spot here for MVP. KT just looking extremely strong. Now up 6,500 gold as they look to push another turret with the last remaining push of their Baron. And it doesn't look like they want to stop there. Pushing now onto the inhibitor turret. Ad in the front trying to deny them. There's the arrow actually onto Deft. Where's the burst damage though? The counter equalizer and beyond, and Ian getting extremely low. Deft still very low though, but a really nice play there by Score to kick Ad into the back. Smeb trying to go man mode now into the base with that Zonya's, but will go down. Pawn now trying to do it himself. It looks like Ad on the back of this will eventually go down. So a 2-4-2, it looks like, but KT with the healthier members, MVP forced to go back, and that will be another inhibitor.
Yeah, KT, they get top inhibitor now as well. Beyond and Ian might try to chase down the members. Never mind, they opt out of it. They're going to protect their base instead. KT now have to be feeling super comfortable at this point as they all recall. Now MVP are in an extremely tough spot. Taking another quick look at this replay, you can see Ian and Beyond waiting as the Enchanted Crystal Arrow comes out. It hits Depth, but there's just no damage. Equalizer in a beautiful spot. Ed goes back in. He had that Guardian Angel, but Maha just couldn't quite finish off Deft. And that redemption came in. Smeb went man mode. He ended up going down. And Pawn almost went down, but able to get out just at the last second. So now coming back into live, a little bit of a skirmish around red. KT probably just want to get Cloud Drake off the map. Looks like Pawn's going to solo that.
Yeah, that is a goal for them. You can see a difference in gold of 3,600. So many turrets taken down, as well as inhibitors after that Baron take. Just looks like one good fight after another for KT as they really pull it together and they begin to look like a team that isn't getting overconfident and is playing as a team. The good KT that we all love and wanted to see. Looking very strong here in game number one, making a good case for them to potentially go up to face Samsung in the next playoff round.
A lot of the things this match that have gotten them to this point is how quick they were to punish the mistakes of MVP and obviously their mechanical ability. So as long as they can keep that going for them in the series, then they should have an easy time continuing to take down MVP. And now, I mean, pushing here in bottom lane, you can see that they're just waiting on mid and top lane, and even if they can't get this inhibitor, they probably are going to, but regardless, Baron's gonna be coming up soon.
A They're looking for that arrow. It misses. They grab Pawn, but no follow-up once again. Really nice equalizer, and Smeb, he's going on in. Getting very low, but will be able to Zhonya's. Maha able to cleanse away, but there's the Nethergrass to follow up for the kill. And now Super Minions banging on the Nexus turrets as KT looks to end game number one.
Yeah, that's probably going to be game number one. The top Nexus turret about to fall. Final Nexus turret going to fall as well. Smeb has teleport. He's going to come back in here in a second.
There he is. And this is just way too many minions. KT just playing with their food now, saying, we're the team that's going to go on to the next round. MVP trying to fight back here. KT making it interesting. But there it is. Game number one goes to KT Rolster.
Really quick. Game number one, actually, at 29 minutes off the back of that very good Baron call. And the mechanics of KT were pretty on point once the mid game arrived in the mid to late transition. MVP, though, they're not totally out of it yet. They've gone down before. And a lot of things could have gone differently. That arrow could have hit Smeb. That was the decisive turnaround. The chain could have hit Deft, and that whole fight in mid-game could have never happened. So as long as they look at it and assess it from that viewpoint and mentally keep it together, they're still looking reasonably okay going into game two.
Yeah, definitely would have to agree. A couple of team fights, if they go the other way, that could have been MVP ahead. But KT looking very confident, and you were talking about how important mental state and just, you know, positivity in that booth is. Well, they're looking really happy. The coaches go in there, pat everybody on the back. And if they can roll this one into a game two win, they're looking really, really strong right now.
Let's see what happens in game number two and if MVP or KT, for that matter, have any special picks in store.
Yeah, so guys, we're gonna be back actually in 15 minutes with game number two.